Hi, this is Michael Megali and Manos Brilakis from the Minneapolis Heart Institute and the Cardiovascular Innovations Foundation, presenting case 78 for the manual of percutaneous coronary intervention. This is a case illustrating some of the options for differentiating calcium versus thrombus, as well as management of the two. The patient was an elderly man who presented with non-ST elevation myocardial infarction. He underwent diagnostic angiography that showed significant disease in a heavily calcified LAD, a CTO of the mid-right coronary artery, and there was also a filling defect within a heavily calcified circumflex artery. Because of the multiple lesions and the presence of severe calcification, the patient was referred for coronary bypass. However, he was turned down mainly because of his age, and he came back for percutaneous coronary intervention. He underwent the right heart catheterization as well that showed fairly normal values, and therefore there was no need for hemodynamic support. Also, because we knew that this was going to be a complex intervention given the severe calcium and possible thrombus, a 45 centimeter long 8-French sheath was used to help with support. So the question is how to treat the circumflex. Is this calcium or is this thrombus? Of course, the treatment is diametrically opposite. If it's thrombus, then we shouldn't do atherectomy. If it is calcium, then atherectomy would be indicated. Therefore, it is important to differentiate this. And although the vessel does have calcium on angiography, it does not preclude the presence of thrombus. So how can we make the differentiation? One option is to use intravascular imaging with OCT or IVUS, and in this particular case we did OCT with OCT catheter delivered distally to the lesion. And this is the OCT run coming from distal to proximal. We see filling defects inside the vessel with absorption of the light, and this is a classic appearance of red thrombus with irregular projections into the lumen, absorbing the light because of the red cells that are included into the thrombus. So OCT did help make the differentiation, showing that actually the patient did not have calcium causing the filling defect, but it was actually thrombus. And this is to differentiate with calcium. Calcium actually usually has sharp borders, and unlike lipid, calcium actually lets the light go through. So we can see the sharp borders, both in the proximal but also distal to the calcium. So this is intraluminal thrombus. The next question is how to treat it. This is obviously a large thrombus. There was undergrade flow. It was a large thrombus. And then the patient did have ongoing ischemia with intermittent symptoms through the previous days. So the options for treating large thrombus is for doing thrombectomy, potentially using a filter to capture any liberated thrombus, and potentially using laser in attempt to vaporize the thrombus. And if thrombectomy is used, there are four options. One is to use one of the various aspiration thrombectomy catheters. The second is to use the Penumbra, which is essentially an aspiration catheter with a pump, providing stronger and more consistent suction. And the third is to aspirate through the guide catheter that is deeply incubated, or through a guide catheter extension. The use of filters for thrombus does not have an indication in the guidelines because early studies in STEMI did not show a consistent benefit. However, for selected cases of large thrombus, it might be useful. And we do have two kinds of filters. One is the filter wine and the second is the spider. The spider has a nitinol mesh coated with heparin, and both of them do need a landing zone to be able to perform PCI proximal to the filter. The filter comes in various sizes that depend on the size of the target vessel. So in this particular case, we decided to use the spider. We advanced the workhorse guide wire, and then this is the spider delivery catheter. One of the advantages of the spider is that it can be delivered over a standard workhorse guide wire, which facilitates wiring through the lesion, especially when the lesions are challenging. After the catheter is there, then the workhorse wire is removed. And then the spider, which is actually inside the delivery catheter, is advanced until it enters the target vessel at the desired location. Once it's there, then the delivery catheter is pulled back, and the filter is deployed, and we can see here it is deployed distal to the lesion. One of the challenges here is we have a major branch coming close to the target lesion. Therefore, there is not enough space to park the filter and protect both branches, but nevertheless, at least we have protection of the largest of the larger distal circumflex branch. The next question is how to remove the thrombus, and we decide to do aspiration thrombectomy. There are various different catheters to perform aspiration thrombectomy, starting from the Export to Priority 1, Quick Cut, Expressway, the Fetch 2, the Pronto LP, Pronto V3, and Pronto V4. It is important to have at least one or two of those catheters in the lab to use them when large thrombus is present. In this case, we decided to use the Export catheter that has a syringe creating vacuum, and we did multiple passes with the Export. Now, one of the challenges when filters are used is that when delivery of equipment is challenging, the filter may be pulled back that can essentially go into the lesion. So it is important to constantly monitor the position of the filter wire to ensure that it doesn't move, and if it does move, to reposition it to prevent it going through the target lesion. Despite the multiple attempts, there was still a filling defect, but we decided to finally stent it, and having the filter did help essentially protect the distal vessel at least partially from distal embolization, and we did have a significant improvement after delivering the stent. However, the stent barely covered the target lesion, and this is one of the limitations of the filter, which is it precludes how far down you can go, because again, you need the landing zone that was limited in this particular patient. We did OCT showing improvement in the lumen, but there was significant stent malapposition. Essentially, the stent is swimming in this very large part of the vessel, and that is why we placed an additional stent, 4.5 by 12, and repeated OCT, and because of the persistent malapposition, we finally postulated everything with a 5-0 by 15 millimeters non-compliant balloon. This provided a nice result. The patient did have a significant calcification in the LAD, but no significant filling defect. And that is why we performed upfront orbital atherectomy, followed by drug-eluting stent placement with high-pressure balloon post-dilatation, and a nice result by angiography as well as OCT. So end of the case, we do have a nice result in the circumflex, no distal embolization, and we also have a nice result into the proximal LAD. So several potential lessons from this case. The first one is how OCT can help differentiate between calcium and thrombus. This is a case where the vessel did have significant calcium, but actually it was a thrombotic lesion that was causing the filling defect, and using the filter as well as thrombectomy helped prevent potential distal embolization and causing a periprocedural myocardial infarction. The other lesson is that for heavily calcified lesions, upfront atherectomy can help both with delivering stents, but also, and sometimes even more importantly, with good stent expansion and stent strata position. Thank you.